and everything else that's going on. I want to congratulate you all for finishing the first week and to thank you for all deciding to argue on. I think it'll be a great experience. We're going to do everything we can to make it a great experience for you. So up until this point, you've gotten a lot of pointers on oral advocacy for people who have basically only been at this for a year or two. And today's your opportunity to actually get some advice for some real professionals who do this as part of their job, real professionals. We have two attorneys from the Texas law firm of Thompson Knight with us today. The first, Nicole Rittenhouse, is a Duke Law graduate. She graduated here in 2003. She was very involved with the Moot Court Board during her time here. I believe she placed second in a national championship, and she was very involved in competitions as well as running the board. Since then, she's been at Thompson & Knight. She's been involved in a program where they actually lend attorneys to a local district attorney's office, and maybe she'll tell you a little about that. And she's gotten a lot of oral advocacy experience there, as well as she has a lot of experience teaching people how to be oral advocates. She coaches the Texas Wesleyan team.
That's right.
And also, David Schulte is a graduate of another very fine law school, but not Duke. But he comes back here to help us out. And he also has a lot of experience both as a litigator doing oral advocacy, as well as he also coaches, I think, the Southern Methodist team.
Which is that other fine law school.
Which is also where he graduated, that other fine law school. So and finally, I just wanted to thank Sarah Wickware, who was one of the people who was on our victorious nationals team, and she's gonna do a brief demo for you as part of this presentation, and then they're gonna talk about it. So I also wanna thank her for coming out today. And without any further ado, I'll turn it off to Nicole and Dave.
Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Chris.
I think Dave and I, this is our second year doing this, and I hope that everyone finds it helpful as we do find it fun. But we'd like to start this out by just kind of congratulating you all for completing the first round of Hardt Cup and for deciding to go on with the second and third rounds, because we truly believe, and now I guess we haven't been practicing that long, but I'm a third year and Dave's now a fourth year, and we truly believe that this is the one of the single best things you can do in law school. It is one of the many things that they offer, such as clinics and mock trial, that gives you some real life experience. But more than anything else, moot court that you do in law school is surprisingly like moot court that you do in real life. It is the way you do appellate arguments. It is the way you argue motions. And it's useful even just beyond that, and talking to clients and doing your everyday job and just knowing how to be persuasive and knowing how to get settlements done, how to mediate, how to do deals. It's so very important. And so I congratulate you all for taking this on, because I know it is a big time commitment, and I wish you all the best of luck. Would you like to start? Dave has a much longer outline than I do.
Well, it's not really so much an outline. It's just some points I'd like to cover. I would like to start this, aside from the stuff that Nicole just said, today is my birthday, and so I just want to point that out.
Don't encourage him.
Anyway, that's the only other thing I was going to ask you today.
I totally forgot.
Yeah, right. All right, so I think we have a series of things that we just wanted to point out. We've been giving workshops this morning, and we're going to continue giving workshops, these sort of one-on-one workshops, both this afternoon and also all day tomorrow. And that kind of gives us a chance to listen to your presentations and then to comment on the types of things that we noticed in your presentation. Most of the time, in fact, every time, everybody is very well-versed on the law. They know what they're talking about. And so it really just boils down to then how you go about presenting that law and how you go about persuading the deciders, the judges in the room, that you're right and that the other side is wrong. So a lot of the things that we point out during these workshops and what we're going to point out today are really just about how to make yourself be more persuasive and come across a little bit better. So to that end, and maybe this is one of the problems with moot court, is that when you guys start with your preparing for oral argument, you kind of take as a starting point your brief. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with that, but you often hear people saying, I'm on brief today, I'm off brief today. But you ought to be off brief all the time, because what you really need to do is structure your oral argument in a way that is often very different from your brief. You have points that you want to make, but it's rare, if ever, that you can actually make the points in the order you have them in your outline or whatever it is you take up to the podium with you. So really, you just ought to have a series of points written down on a piece of paper that you want to make, and you're going to get thrown off base with questions. You're going to have to deal with stuff in a different order just because of the questions that are asked. And so to that end, that'll help you avoid common problems that we see, like reading, bad eye contact, having your presentation sound like a law review article or a speech. And really, it'll kind of further the goal of having the oral argument be more like a conversation with the judges, which is really what it is. Oral argument is really nothing more than a series of questions and answers, a lot of back and forth, and it ought to sound a lot more like a conversation.
Just building on that point before you go on, Dave, I think it's very important that you recognize that what you go up with the podium to the podium with and what you prepare beforehand should not be a written speech. It should not be you assuming you're going to talk for 10 minutes to the judges and you're going to tell them in this very eloquent language that you've scripted out exactly what you want to say. And there's a few reasons for that. The first is that anytime you memorize something and then tell it to somebody, you're less persuasive. It's not persuasive to sound like you've memorized a speech and you're giving it. And if you're fortunate enough to be one of those people who can memorize something and then still deliver it with some sort of passion and authority, you're probably, in the short period of time that you've had to prepare, not really going to be able to have memorized it the best way. And so you'll start to stumble over a word and you'll think, that's not the word in my script. And then you're going to get messed up. And I've seen that happen to a lot of people. So what you really need to do when you prepare is you need to figure out what the issues are and what are the points you want to make. And not, I want to make the point that, and I've been listening to a lot of ADA stuff this morning, so apologize for this example, but you want to make the point that the ADA should cover websites. You don't want to make the point that if you look at the plain language of the American with Disabilities Act, it clearly encompasses websites because Section 12182 says this. That's not your point. Your point is the ADA covers websites. And if you remember that, that's all you need to remember because you know the law and you know the cases. And when you get asked, why does it cover websites, you'll start talking about those cases. There's no reason to have the exact language.
That is so well put. I want to throw in a few other points to that same end. It shouldn't be the case when you're giving oral arguments that your argument is flooded with legalese. And so if the word a justum generic comes out at any point during your oral argument, it better be because a judge brought it up and not because you brought it up. It doesn't add anything to your argument. It only subtracts. You need to boil that down to what you're really saying. What you're really saying is that the statute gives a series of limitations as to what the statute covers. And then this broad sweeping language at the end of the statute is limited. It's not what a plaintiff's attorney would refer to as just sort of a catch-all. It's the catch-all is still limited by the very specific terms or the types of terms that precede it. And so that's really the reason why. You don't win because of a justum generic. You win because of the way the statute is written. So.
And I think that kind of goes to, I hope we haven't confused some people in our individual workshops, the way that you write a brief is very different from the way that you argue orally because you've only got, in this case, 10 minutes, but even in real life, in the Fifth Circuit, you've only got 20 minutes to talk about what is a really complex case that sides and lots of amici have written on. And so you don't approach it the same way you do a brief. You don't use the same specific language you would use. You don't say, point, counterpoint. You don't stand up in oral argument, and we'll talk about this in a minute, and say, the First Circuit agrees with me, but by the way, the Ninth Circuit doesn't agree with me, but let me go ahead and tell you why not. That's not what you do in oral argument, but you would do that in a brief. So don't think that when we say, don't use the proper name of statutory construction, that we don't mean you wouldn't write that in a brief. We mean that in the 10 minutes you have, you don't want to spend 2 minutes of it trying to get this word out, then trying to explain what this word really means, and then eventually getting on to the point that you really want to make, which is why you win.
Because people don't talk like that, and people don't talk like that in a conversation, which is really what Moot Court is all about. Let's talk about procedural history. Procedural history is the boring part of cases that you guys always skip over, I'm sure, in all your cases. But it's especially important in real life, and it's especially important in Moot Court. So if you lose at the trial court on a summary judgment motion and that's affirmed and you're now in the Supreme Court, the standard of review is de novo because you're looking at the record as a whole. But more important than that is you need to ask yourself the types of things that you need to prove if you lost or won on summary judgment. And those are the types of things that you need to constantly remember and weave into your oral argument. So if you lost on summary judgment and you're a plaintiff in an ADA case, you need to show that there are genuine issues of material fact in the record. You don't necessarily need to win your case. You don't need to prove that you're entitled ultimately to prevail. You just have to show that there are genuine issues of material fact. Don't make your job harder at oral argument than what it really is. You may lose in front of a jury, but there are at the very least, there are issues that ought to be decided by a jury. This becomes even more important in the ADA case that we saw today, which was decided apparently on a 12B6 motion to dismiss. And at 12B6, the standard is even more important because, as a general rule, Rule 12B6 motions are disfavored, and all the allegations in the complaint are read in the light most favorable to the plaintiff. And so you have to, is it really the case the plaintiff has alleged no set of facts that would entitle him to prevail at trial? Maybe not. I don't know. Maybe he loses as a matter of law. But that's what you ultimately have to show. You don't have to show that you're going to win this lawsuit in a huge verdict. You don't even have to show that you're going to get past summary judgment. You just have to show, I just need to take some discovery. And I just need to go back to the trial court and move on, go about my business. But I need to have that opportunity. And I've pleaded enough to get to that point. And so that's why standard of review and procedural history are pretty important.
Yeah, and it's important not just because your judges will expect you to know it, but because sometimes your procedural posture gives you the best answer to questions that you could possibly hope for. Because, I mean, moot court is artificial in the sense only that they skew the problems so that both sides have an equal chance of winning, which is often not the case. But what often happens in moot court is they skew it in a way so that even though the plaintiff would probably ultimately win, your procedural posture is an MSJ. And if they ultimately win, that doesn't necessarily mean they win on MSJ. So as a defendant who's probably ultimately going to lose this case, your argument is not so much I ultimately win this case, as Dave is saying. Your argument is I have at least put forth enough evidence that a jury should get to decide this case, that you shouldn't throw this case out before I ever even get the chance to try it before a jury, that my client deserves to have a jury of his peers hear this case and decide whether or not he did anything wrong. So it's important to keep that in mind, because sometimes that is the only answer you can give. Sometimes that is your best way to, we'll talk about this later, what I call go running from a question. It gives you a way out. If you're the plaintiff and you think maybe you don't ultimately, and I don't know all the facts of the ADA case, but even if maybe ultimately a pure internet website is not a case, if you could set forth a set of facts where there would be a website that people can look at for games, but this website also happens to be run out of a building that people can come into and also sit where your server is and gamble on computers, well, then maybe you could win that case. And maybe that's not what the facts will ultimately show, but if you can say that and that would win, that's all you need for 12B6. So you need to be thinking of things like that in your mind that will help you answer questions.
Right. Okay. I mentioned earlier, we've both mentioned that the whole point of moot court is that it's like a conversation. And it's really about asking questions and answering those questions and seeing if you get rattled or if you can handle all the pressure. So Nicole and I think have a lot of the points that we are going to make have to do with the answering of questions. And so I think, do you want to go rapid fire back and forth with some points?
Sure.
All right. I think we each have a bunch. So take notes. All right, go ahead.
Okay. The first thing I'll say, and I've seen a lot of this morning, is you've got to answer the question that was asked. Don't answer the question that you wish they'd asked. Don't answer the question that you were sort of half listening to, because halfway through the question you decide what you were going to say. If I ask you the question, what does the statute say? The first words out of your mouth need to be what the statute says. If I ask you the question, would you agree that blank, the first words out of your mouth have got to be, yes, I would agree, or no, I wouldn't agree, and then because this. What a lot of people do, I think there's two things that go on. One is they think they're answering the question by starting an answer that will eventually get you there. So I say, well, would you agree that the statute says this? And they say, well, if we go look at section whatever, we see that this, and then if we go look at section this, so no, I don't think that's what the statute says. That's not helpful for you or for the judge, because one, they have no idea what your answer is. Yes or no, do you agree with me or disagree? I don't know that. Then you start this long explanation, I don't have any idea where you're going, and if you're even lucky enough to finish it, maybe I eventually see your point, but what I'm left with in my mind is they didn't answer my question, and then that seemed to take a really long time to get to the simple answer of no. So you always need to put no or yes or whatever the answer to the question is first. The second thing that goes on is I think people start to hear questions. You know where you think the judge is going. You know the point you want to make. And so you just make that point instead of actually listening to what the question was. And while it is important to know where the judge is going and where you want to go, you need to answer the question first and then get to where the judge is going. And you would be amazed at the number of points you get just by the simple thing that the 2L who's judging you doesn't write down yes or no. Yes or no. I mean, I must have written that down in every single Hardt Cup round that I judged. Yes or no. If you just do that, you leave them with the impression that you've answered the question, you were listening, now you're going to explain to them why you're right, and so then you start to get transitioning points as well.
A point that I always like to make is the importance when answering questions of not just giving conclusions, but explaining why and giving the facts that support that conclusion. And the example I always give is not in the moot court context, but in the practice of law. I said, and this just came to me. I sent out some interrogatories in a case, and I got my answers back about a month ago. And I said, it was a contention interrogatory, and I said, please identify all ways in which you contend my client was negligent. And here's the incredible answer I got after all the boilerplate objections. I got this. Your client was negligent because he owed my client a duty, and he breached that duty. And the breach of that duty proximately caused my client damages. Fantastic. And so I bring that up to show anybody can get up in answering a question and give a conclusion like that. But the conclusion actually has to have some substance. I knew what the elements of a negligence claim were. And I think all of you guys know too. But I need to know what duty it is my client owed and how. That was unreal. I don't even see who did that, but bless you. But you need to get. But what I needed to know was how. How did my guy breach this unspecified duty? And how is it that you reach the $1 million damages that you're asking for in your complaint? You know, that's what I needed to know, and I got none of that. So you always need to remember to include facts and not just conclusions. And before I pass it back, I want to say just one other thing. After you've answered a question, I coached a moot court team over at SMU. We just competed in Seattle a couple weeks ago, and I heard this from another team, not my team, during oral argument. After answering a question, she looked at the judge and she said, have I answered your question, judge? Have I fully addressed your concerns? And by asking that, it may seem respectful. You want to make sure you've covered all your bases, right? Wrong. Because all you've done when asking that question is shown the judge that you haven't even convinced yourself that your answer is right. How could you possibly expect the judge to be satisfied with your answer? You can't. So you have to, part of it is being so persuasive in your answer that you leave no doubt in your mind or in the minds of the judges that you've answered the question, and then you segue directly back into your argument.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. Dave and I, sadly enough, talk about moot court all the time. And one of the things that we talk about, and actually this is true in real life too, it's not so much what you're saying, but how you say it. I mean, obviously you need to know the law and you need to know the facts, but the thing is, almost everybody does. You're never going to go up against somebody in court who doesn't know the facts of the case that you're arguing about. So the person who's more persuasive and the person who often wins is the person who is able to convince other people that they're correct. And so you don't need to do anything that detracts from your ability to persuade people. One of the most important things is that you have got to think you're right. And even if you don't think you're right, you've got to at least be presenting it to people as though you think you're right. And things like saying, I think, or the ADA should cover, or I think is the best example, or I'm arguing before you today that blank. I mean, those things aren't persuasive. You need to just say it like you mean it. The ADA covers the internet. Mr. Councilman should not have criminal charges against him. You've got to say it just like that. And in the context of answering questions, you need to, even if you think you haven't maybe really answered the question, leave the impression that you have answered the question. asking, have I answered your question? Obviously the worst example, but pausing after a question for some sort of affirmation from the judge that you're correct, it's not coming. I mean, even if you are correct, it's not coming. And now you've paused, and now everybody's like, well, why are we sitting here?
Yeah, if you ever expect a judge to be like, oh, yes, yes, it all makes perfect sense now. It's not gonna happen.
Yeah, it's not coming. And just, you don't ever want to give the impression that you're not sure about what you just said, or you don't think you're right. You know, if you're up there and you can't remember the section number, but you've started to say the section number, don't go 12-1753. Just say 12-828, section 17. Because honestly, I mean, the judge does not know whether or not...
videotaped.
I know. The judge does not know whether or not you just said the section number right. The section number's right in your brief. You know what the section number is. Everybody knows you're talking about the ADA. I mean, in fact, I would recommend trying to just eliminate section numbers from your argument for that very reason. You know, I'd talk about the ADA, and I'd talk about the ADA exception number, whatever. But the thing is, like, you don't want to appear as though you're stumbling around trying to remember what law you're arguing about in this case. That's just not persuasive.
Yeah, it's also just part of cutting out a lot of the legalese. I mean, why do you want your oral argument to read like a law review article or the brief that you submitted for this case? I mean, this isn't about reciting every possible or potentially applicable statute. It's about arguing how these statutes come into play under the facts of this case. What's most important are the facts, the record, the underlying law, but not your ability to recite and cite to statutes. Let's see. I want to also point out just a general thing. This came up last year in the team I was coaching, and it happened to a girl that was on my team. And she was asked a question by a current member of the Texas Supreme Court. And he asked it very light-spoken, even though he was mic'd up, just like I am. And he said something like, "Counsel, what do you think about this?" It was incoherent. And she's like, "I'm sorry, Your Honor, I couldn't understand your question. Would you mind repeating it?" He was like, "Yeah." And she's like, "Judge, I just can't hear you. You mind repeating it?" And all at that, he sort of got up out of his chair. He's like, "Counsel, this is my courtroom, and you need to pay attention when you're in it." And she's like, "Oh, okay. And so and then he said it one more time, and it was audible, and she answered it. After the fact, it came out that he doesn't really speak that way, and he wasn't even really angry. He just wanted to see what her response would be to being put in that situation. And it reminded me of what is a very good point, is that, and it really goes back to some of the things that we've already pointed out, is that moot court is really an opportunity for judges to gauge your performance to different sets of circumstances. And it's not just so much answering questions, but how you answer them and how you react to things that could possibly come up in a courtroom, such as that. And so he was just testing her. He wasn't really angry. So bear that in mind if you have a difficult situation, that they're really just testing you. So no one's really angry at you, unless you say something stupid. Nicole?
No, I think that's a good point. Because, I mean, a lot of judges really get into their role. And I'll admit that I've seen judges, you know, 3Ls who just want to see what they can do to you. And you know, unfortunately, I think it does happen in real life, too. Some judges just like to see if they can rattle people, especially, you know, maybe if they already know which way it's going to go for sure. And I don't mean trying to make people cry or anything that extreme, but, you know, presenting you with a situation and just seeing what you do with it. And I often see people, I'll ask them questions, and I'm really playing devil's advocate. I mean, I'm really saying, but counsel, I mean, do you really think that's what the statute says? Because couldn't it say this instead? And I think people falsely assume that whatever comes out of a judge's mouth is what they think, that that's what I would interpret the statute to be, or that's how I think the case is going to come out. And it's not. It's just me trying to see if you've thought about this and trying to see how you're going to tell me that's wrong. And so don't assume that the judge disagrees with you and take, especially not a disrespectful stance with the judge, but, you know, don't get angry. Don't take it personally. Don't tell the judge that's irrelevant or that that's a stupid point. But you also don't want to tell the judge later, well, Your Honor, you know, as you were arguing earlier, blank. The judge isn't arguing. The judge is just pointing things out to you. They're not necessarily trying to mess you up. They're just trying to point things out. And if you take questions in that manner as, The judge has pointed something out to you, and of course, you have a brilliant counterpoint. That's how you need to approach it. The judge points something out to you, say, no, Your Honor, respectfully, I disagree, this, blah, blah, blah. No, Your Honor, the statute actually says this, or no, Your Honor, those aren't the facts of this case. Those are all perfectly acceptable answers. Those are very persuasive answers, as long as you deliver them in a respectful manner. Just don't assume the judge is out to get you, or that anything's personal, or that they necessarily even believe what they're saying, because they really don't. Sometimes they just already think they know, but they need you to back it up with something. So keep that in mind.
That's gold. I also want to add, this. This is as an example of how these things, I mean, what Nicole, I'm not being facetious about that. It really is gold. Nicole and I share all the same moot court philosophies, and we try to implement all those in our teams that we coach. I want to add this, though. This is a real-life example. I saw this. This is the same girl that was not convinced of her own answers and asked the judges if they were convinced. She, during, this is in Seattle a couple weeks ago, she says, judge, she got asked a question. She's like, Your Honor, let me rephrase your question so that I can understand it. Wow. Anyway, it just has to do with proper decorum and dealing with the question you're asked, not the one that you wish was asked, or recouching the question of the judge. I want to visit with you all briefly about the sort of the stature or the positions you guys have as petitioner respondent and then ultimately on rebuttal. As petitioners, you have the unique opportunity to be the first person to put out your side of the story. And in that sense, the psychological principles of primacy and recency come into play. You really want to start off on the right foot when you're talking with the court, because how you set it up is going to dictate, really, I think, how the whole one-hour proceeding goes. And one of the things that you can do as petitioner is that you can anticipate the arguments that respondent is going to make and undercut them immediately. And you can sort, and the way you can do this is you can say, respondent is going to argue X, and then give a really dumbed down version of what that means and how it's going to apply, and then you undercut it and you really make them look silly when they get up there. Because they ultimately, if they're paying attention, they're going to get up there and feel the need to sort of respond to your attack on their argument, and it's going to mess them up. It's great. When you're respondent, you need to respond to arguments. You can't just give your argument in a vacuum as if the last 30 minutes never happened. You really have to get up there and respond to arguments that are made. Now, a lot of times that coincides with your argument, but sometimes it's important to weave in or to at least show the judges that you were paying attention the last 30 minutes and not just memorizing your outline points. So you might say something like, petitioner got up here a few minutes ago and argued X, but that's off the mark, and here's why. Or, as Your Honor pointed out about 10 minutes ago, X. And that is really the linchpin of this case, and this is why. Bam. On rebuttal, people sometimes misunderstand the purpose of rebuttal, and rebuttal is not an opportunity for you to rehash arguments that have already been made, or to emphasize them, or to strenuously make the same arguments you've already made. But it's a point really to give discrete responses to arguments made by the respondent during their case. Not global concepts, but really to pick up on a few isolated things, attack them, and make those arguments your own.
Are you done?
I think so.
One thing I'd like to talk about, we've talked about a little bit this morning in the one-on-one sessions, is how you use case law in your argument. And we've talked a little bit about how you need to give answers up front, you need to give conclusions up front, and then you need to explain what's going on. And that's kind of what this point goes to. It's important to remember that, I mean, case law is important. I'm not saying it's not important. It really is very important. But case law is not the answer to your problem. It's not the answer to your client's problems. It's not the answer to the judge's questions. Dave and I like to say a case is an answer only to two questions. One is, what case is that? And two is, do you have any authority for what you've just said? Those are the only two times where I ask you a question and the first thing out of your mouth should be, well, Your Honor, the Ninth Circuit in whatever said this. That's not the answer to the question. Now, what the case is about might be the answer to the question, or what the court held might be the answer to the question, but Dave's recent philosophy that he expressed to me is adopting the rationale of a case as though it's your own, and then backing it up with the case, and that it really is what you do. The answer to the question, well, why should the internet be held to be a place? If your answer is that car parts case where somebody else held that a non-actual physical facility was a place, the answer isn't, well, Your Honor, because in car parts, the First Circuit said this. The answer is because, Your Honor, under the definitions as listed in the statute, a non-physical place can be a place of public accommodation. For example, a health insurance policy can be a place, as the First Circuit held in car parts. And I don't know if everything I've said is exactly correct, so I apologize for that. But
that's, it doesn't have to be correct because it sounds correct.
Unfortunately, that is the reality. But that's how you use case law. You give the answer. You give the reason your answer is right, and then you back it up with case law. What is more persuasive than any, you know, 314 F3D 272? That doesn't persuade anybody. What persuades somebody is a statement that makes sense. It's logical. It looks at the language of the statute. It interprets it in a manner that makes sense. And then you say, and by the way, this really makes sense because the 5th, 11th, and 8th circuits all agree that what I said is brilliant. And then if there's a case that maybe disagrees with that, if it's not binding authority, you don't volunteer it. You've only got 20 minutes. You don't want to spend your 20 minutes explaining why you're not wrong. You want to explain why you're right. If there's a bad case out there, well, if it's binding authority, because we are having this discussion this morning, if it's binding authority, you've got to bring it up. You can't avoid it. And if it's persuasive authority, you definitely need to be ready to talk about it. But you don't need to be volunteering counterpoints to your own argument. That's the other side's job. That's not your job.
My first job out of law school, I was a clerk for a federal judge in Fort Worth, and he said something to me I'll never forget. He said, Dave, the law purports to be logical. And that makes sense. And that's, I think, ultimately what guides most judges' decisions, is whether something makes sense. And if there's an opinion out there that holds one way, and it's just persuasive and not mandatory authority, but it doesn't make any sense, a judge isn't going to follow that opinion. Why would he? Why would you follow a decision that doesn't make any sense just because there's a decision? What ultimately prevails is logic and the rationale of these cases. And that's the reason why we say, set forth the rationale of the case and then buttress it with the opinion that you got that rationale from. Because that's the more logical thing to do, is give the logic first and then say that there's a case out there that supports your logic. It's much more persuasive. I have a couple other little things. I saw a lot of it this morning. They're very nitpicky. But these are I've often found in competitions that there's very little that separates the winning team from the losing team, both in terms of their presentation, but also in terms of the points that are awarded by the judges to the competitors. And it's often these little things that make the difference. So I'm going to throw these out there, take them for what they're worth. Get rid of the first-person pronouns, the I argue, the we's, get rid of all that stuff, and really personalize your clients. It's Game Master, it's Capretti, or whatever the plaintiff's name is. But really personalize the case. Remind the court that we're dealing with real people and real business entities, real people whose access to the internet might be affected. You might not be able to play blackjack anymore online. And then there are real business entities whose finances might be affected by the outcome in this case. Let's see, get rid of the fluff words, the we believes, the we contend, we submit to the court that. It's nonsense. Just cut it out, and it's more persuasive when you get right to the point. Always remember that this is something what I'm about to tell you here, I'm violating my own trade secrets here, because I'm going to give you all a little something that I don't really share outside my team, but this is what I commonly refer to as the essence of your argument. And it came up this morning in the ADA case. And the essence of that argument, if you're a plaintiff, it seems to me, I didn't study the case, but it seems to me that if you're a plaintiff and you want the ADA to cover internet websites, the essence of your argument is, we live in an evolving society where nowadays there are banks that don't even have real doors and roofs. There are banks that do all their operations online. And this is sort of the way our society has become. There's no more doing deals with handshakes. You have electronic signatures. People don't even meet, and they're doing business and making contracts. Is it the case in this modern world we live in that blind people can't participate? It seems a little weird, and it seems like that can't possibly be what Congress intended. That's really good, I think. But anyway, I didn't study the problem, but I think that that's the essence of your argument, and I think that if you bear in mind, if you really just sit back and think about what a case is about from your perspective, you might get asked a question during the competition that you didn't possibly anticipate, or maybe you get asked a question about a case that you didn't anticipate. But if you bear in mind the essence of your argument, it's going to answer the question that you hadn't prepared for 9 times out of 10, or it'll at least provide sort of the groundwork to give you a start to answering the question. Little things that people don't often talk about is sitting with posture when you're at the council table, having posture and having good mannerisms at the podium, keeping when you're not arguing, you're just sitting at a council table, having a nice orderly setup. You know, I saw last when I was in Seattle, there's this table, they had papers all over the place, they had tabs, post-it notes, and pens, and highlighters. It was chaos. I wasn't even in the competition, but I was frazzled, just looking at her table. So you gotta keep the area clean, pay attention during the other side's argument, don't be talking or passing a bunch of notes or studying your outline, but really paying attention to what's going on. And then apparel is something that I always stress with my team, but really making sure that you look professional when you go into the courtroom. I give a couple examples of that. There was a guy who wore a suit at last year's competition. He had a toothpaste on his tie and some kind of red, I guess it was like spaghetti sauce on his collar. Ludicrous. Why you would walk into a courtroom, the Supreme Court of all places, in that sort of disarray is beyond my comprehension. There was a girl last year in the competition who had the most ridiculously short skirt I've ever seen in my life. It was like club attire. So you always have to bear in mind where you are and who you're arguing to and what your audience is. And the biggest example of this is this. There was a girl last year, I thought her hair looked fine. She had curly hair, she had dyed it. There's some red in it, stuff like that, but it was down. And there's a female judge who didn't ask a single question for all 60 minutes, and she only gives one comment after the round when they're going around the room and all the judges are giving their criticism. She's like, "Your hair, you really need to put that up." And I was just like, this girl just gave, you know, a really good argument for 15 minutes, but the substance of her argument was disregarded because of her appearance. Now, while that's a rather extreme example, the bottom line is this. Even if you sound incredible, and even if you have the best arguments, and you answer questions beautifully, if you do something stupid, either with your apparel or your mannerisms, it totally distracts from your argument, and it subtracts credibility from you, which means you're going to get less points, you're probably going to lose the round.
And I think it is all about not wanting to distract from your argument, because as unfair as it sounds, I mean, it happens every day. If you watched, when I was at Duke, I got the opportunity to be on a research program where we taped actual juries and then watched what they did and did a study on it. And it's just appalling. I mean, juries come back and they're like, "Did you see that woman's shoes? Ugh, I hate her." And they don't decide with them. I mean, unfortunately, sometimes that just happens. So what you want to do is, you know, you don't recognize that that has any validity at all, because it doesn't, and it shouldn't happen. But you have to recognize that it does, and so you want to eliminate the possibility that that's ever going to happen. If you do have kind of crazy hair, if you're a guy and you like to spike it up, just don't when you go to argue. If you're a girl and your hair tends to get in your face, or you tend to play with it, I play with my hair all the time. I pull my hair back in a ponytail anytime I go to court, because I don't want the judge to remember me as the girl who sat at counsel table playing with her hair. Don't wear a suit that's like neon green, as I have seen women wear to court. I mean, just don't do anything that distracts. The same way you wouldn't take a pen up with you and argue and just be going like this. I mean, no one has any idea what you're saying. They're just watching you play with your pen. You don't do that. You don't play with your watch. You don't shuffle your papers. You don't do any of that stuff. It's all about not distracting from your own argument.
It seems like common sense stuff. I mean, maybe some of you are thinking, well, God, why would I ever do that? That doesn't make any sense. Why would I go to work with spaghetti sauce on my shirt? Why would I flick a pen around when I'm arguing in front of the Supreme Court? Yet it happens. It happens not only in moot court, but it happens in real life. I saw people during oral argument when I was clerking that did all these sort of distractions that we're talking about today. These are things that somewhere along the line, no one taught them apparently not to take a pen up to the table. No one taught them to put on a clean shirt in the morning. It seems alarming, but it happens. Just take those things for what they're worth. We had a thing come up this morning where the guy, Nicole touched on it, the thing about bringing up bad authority, and it was needless. And I came up with this analogy, which I think is apropos. It was you go on a date, for the first time, and you're meeting this person for the first time. And the idea when you go on a date is the first impressions are everything. You want to put your best foot forward. Why reveal bad facts, right? And really, oral argument is no different than a dating situation. You're not going to walk in and be like, now, I had a rough childhood. I was abused. I didn't get any attention. I probably won't be a very good father. It'd be like, okay, first and last date right there. You know, it's the same thing in moot court. You know, you're not going to be like, well, there is that Ninth Circuit case out there. It's pretty bad. And it seems ridiculous, but people have a tendency to sort of bring up things that are bad. Now, you have to address the bad if it's asked for. Now, counsel, tell me about this Ninth Circuit case. It seems to go directly against what you're saying here. Okay, Your Honor. Yeah, let me talk about that. Blah, 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 blah. But no, there's no reason to volunteer this. Only talk about the good. Put your best foot forward. Like that.
I think part of the problem is just the, I guess, fake situation you've been put in where you don't really have a real client and you've had to look at both sides of the issue. So the whole time you're arguing, all you can think in your head is, well, the other side's going to be able to say this because I'm not really right. And you've got to put that out of your minds. When you're up there for petitioner, you have to be only thinking about petitioner. You don't need to be worried about what you would have said if you were respondent. Because frankly, half the time, they won't have thought of what you thought of on respondent anyway. So you're needlessly anticipating something that's not even going to happen. But I mean, in real life, you know who your client is, and you know what the bad authority is, but you haven't sunk yourself into it the way you will in moot court. So it's not quite as big of a problem, but I totally agree with everything Dave said.
Especially the dating analogy?
Especially the dating analogy. As far as like just what you're doing when you're sitting at counsel table, I never really thought about that being important, but it really is because you don't want to be distracting, and more importantly, you don't want it to look like you don't respect the other people in the room, the judges or the opposing counsel. You don't want to be, while they're arguing, making any kind of audible noises like, ah, or bad point, or like scribbling frantically like you think they're wrong. Those just really aren't things that you want to do. I guess, yeah, we need to let Sarah argue because we're talking too long. We're going to have Sarah just do a quick argument for you guys, and then she's graciously allowed us to critique her. But maybe you'll also get to see her do, since she did win the National Moot Court Competition, a lot of the things that we're talking about.
She missed the mark.
But I think you'll see her do a lot of the stuff that we're talking about and see some kind of ways that you get out of sticky situations and put your best foot forward.
There will be a lot of critique. I haven't looked at this argument in quite a while, so well, I'll probably be doing the things they just said not to. Who's the chief?
I'll be the chief.
Okay. And also, this is a 20-minute argument. I guess we're just going to go for a few minutes.
Yeah, we'll just do
it's
like
not
10.
Really tailored to the time either. I feel the need to. Madam Chief Justice, and may it please the court, my name is Sarah Wickware, counsel for the respondent, Walt Rides Corporation. Your Honors, this is a case about the deeply rooted American ethos of protecting private property against undue government interference. This court should find in favor of the respondent for two reasons. First, Local Law 25 deprives Walt Rides of all economically beneficial use of its property and therefore constitutes a per se taking. And second, and in the alternative, weighing Local Law 25's interference with investment-backed expectations and the economic interest of the property owner against the nature of the government action compels the conclusion that a taking has occurred.
Isn't what really deprives your client of the beneficial use of its property its refusal to abide by local rule, which implements simple safety features on amusement park rides?
No, Your Honor. In fact, Walt Rides has alleged on pages 6 and 7 of the complaint that it's prohibitively expensive to comply with Local Law 25 and as such has been evicted. In fact, the procedural posture of this case is critically important.
But we're talking about seatbelts and cushions on seats, right?
Absolutely.
And that's prohibitively expensive.
Yes, Your Honor. This case comes before this court on a 12B6 motion to dismiss, and as such, all of the facts in the complaint must be taken as true. And more importantly, Walt Rides is simply seeking the opportunity to prove its case to the district court.
Well, but counsel, I mean, we don't have to accept things as true that are just merely conclusory statements or legal conclusions. So do you really think that you can come into court and just write down prohibitively expensive in your complaint and then have us say, oh, well, it must be prohibitively expensive. Let's let them engage in expensive discovery against the state?
No, Your Honor. It's not a legal conclusion. It's a factual conclusion. And Walt Rides is in the best position to know its own financial data. And again, here it just seeks the opportunity to provide to the district court whatever financial analysis the court would like to see to prove that a taking has occurred. In this case, the 14th Circuit simply didn't go so far as to say that a taking had occurred, but instead said a taking may well have occurred. And again, Walt Rides simply seeks for affirmance of the 14th Circuit and a remand to prove its case. One of the things Your Honors discussed at length with petitioners is the correct characterization of the property interest. Where the petitioner's argument goes astray is in their overly broad characterization of the property interest. Each of Walt Rides' 10 lots is already a discrete piece of property. The record at page 2 clearly indicates that Walt Rides is required to pay a monthly rent on each of the 10 lots, plus 6% overage on revenues greater than $15,000.
But counsel, I mean, didn't your client, in fact, decide that they weren't discrete lots when it signed one lease governing all these properties?
Your Honor, the lease is one way to interpret this. However, the gain or loss in this situation is according to the economic unit. Therefore, it makes sense in this case to consider the property interest, the economic unit.
Well, how is this different from a case where you have a builder who owns a subdivision with 100 different lots and the case that holds that you can't single out one of those 100 lots and have the developer say, I was deprived of all economically beneficial use of this one lot?
Except for in discrete circumstances, this court has repeatedly declined to adopt bright line rules in the takings context and instead has preferred an ad hoc factual inquiry. So it's different from that case in a number of areas, and again, the court would be required to look at all of the facts. Even if, however, this court disagrees that Walt Rides has been deprived of all economically beneficial use of its property, and even if this court finds that the 10 lots should be looked at collectively, a taking has still occurred under the Penn Central balancing test that this court laid down. There, the court looks to three factors. Turning first to the expectations, this court has said that expectations must be both reasonable and investment-backed. The court looks to a variety of things in determining expectations. One of them, for example, is whether the property owner acquired the property after the regulation being challenged was passed.
It seems to me that this sort of analysis requires that you take a look at a very complete factual record. Am I right?
You are.
How does that affect your case?
Well, Your Honor, to the extent that there is a dearth of evidence on this record, Walt Rides is simply asking for the opportunity to go back and factually develop the record. In fact, because the takings inquiry is a fact-based analysis, there's no way for the court in this case to determine that a taking could not have occurred because it didn't undergo that factual analysis this court requires in the Penn Central balancing test.
I'm not sure that there is a set of facts that you could set forth that would convince me, because you operate a roller coaster company. And it doesn't really matter to me what the regulations were 10, 15 years ago when you got this lot. Operating a roller coaster, I think that any reasonable person would expect there to be safety regulations. And so how does the fact that you had the privilege of operating without safety regulations for a period of time give you the right to say it was unforeseeable that in the future there would be such safety regulations?
Well, Your Honor, one of the things the court looks to is investment-backed expectations. Here, Walt Rides is not asking or contending that it should be free from any and all safety regulations in the future. And indeed, its response to Local Law 15 suggests as much. When Local Law 15 was enacted, Walt Rides took all necessary steps to comply with those impositions. At some point, however, a regulation will constitute a taking. As Justice Holmes noted in Pennsylvania Coal, regulations are permissible until they go too far. This regulation goes too far because it regulates to the point of putting Walt Rides out of the business of operating the jet plane and the Bel Air.
And yet, without the jet plane and the Bel Air, you're contending in this case that that those properties are being deprived of all economic benefit. Is that correct? Yes or no?
Yes, the properties upon which the jet plane and the Bel Air sit.
Right, but it's not this local law that you cite does not require you, if there's no jet plane or Bel Air, you can't do anything with the property, correct?
Your Honor, I see that my time has elapsed. May I answer your question?
Sure. It's just a yes-no question, though.
Correct.
Okay, so my understanding then is that your client could do any number of things with this property so long as it's not a jet plane or Bel Air that doesn't comply with this public law. You could put any number of businesses there that presumably would make your client some money. So it's not the case that you're being deprived of all economic benefit from the property, are you?
We are, Your Honor. Look, Walt Rides has been evicted, and more importantly, that improperly shifts the burden to the property owner. If the town is behaving in an unconstitutional manner, the burden is not on the property owner to mitigate whatever economic devastation the town is causing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fair enough.
Yikes.
I got to tell you, I've seen in my day a number of good advocates, but that is a really good example of really good advocacy and really getting up there and answering the question that's asked and just really having a great presentation and being very persuasive. That's a fine example of the types of things that we look for. I mean, of particular note, I'm a big fan of procedural posture, which we talked about earlier, and she incorporated in response to one of my questions. She didn't throw in procedural posture as a standalone deal. In response to one of my questions, she threw in the 12B6 standard, which is all that is really before the court today. And that's really genius, because she's saying that she doesn't have to win the case. She only has to do enough to get past 12B6. Let us go take some discovery. Maybe I'll lose on summary judgment. Maybe I'll lose in front of a jury. But I've done enough right now. And I just think that's really good. Since she's left, I would not have used the legal term ethos to begin with, or I don't even know what that is. And the only other thing is she said that this case is different from that case in a number of ways, and yet I don't think any of those ways were articulated. And so that's one area of improvement I might suggest, is that if you're going to say something is different in a number of ways, that's a conclusion. And then you have to give the facts that support that conclusion, which is the ways in which this case is different from that case, which would be a more complete answer to her question asking about the subdivision with 100 different lots.
That's important. Don't ever say you're going to say anything that you don't plan on saying or that you never get to. It's the same thing you'll hear when you take any mock trial classes. Don't tell the jury you're going to tell them something, and then don't tell them, because that's all the other side is going to talk about in response. You know, they said they were going to tell you this, and they didn't. Just a couple of the questions Dave asked her reminded me of some things that came up this morning, and I'm just going to go through these real quick. It seemed that some people weren't exactly sure the proper way to deal with certain kinds of questions. The first one is what Dave and I call softball questions. Somebody asks you a question that helps your argument. First of all, you've got to recognize these. You know, sometimes it happens because a judge really doesn't understand your case as well as you do. So they think they've asked you something difficult when in fact they've asked you something that helps you. And sometimes they actually are trying to help you. Recognize they've asked you a helpful question and just hit it out of the park. Say, exactly, Your Honor, that's exactly the point. Yes, Your Honor, I completely agree. It's not inappropriate to do that. So just take those and run with them. The second one is off-point questions.
Is that what I was asking?
Well, yeah, sometimes.
Okay.
Dave asked a question this morning to someone arguing the councilman problem about conspiracy and whether or not people within a corporation can conspire with each other. And it's kind of relevant to the facts of the case, but it's not relevant to the issue on appeal, and I don't think y'all researched that, so you didn't have any reason to know what the answer to that question was. When a judge asks you a question that's off point or that's irrelevant, what you need to do is answer the question as quickly as you can, as concisely as you can, and get back to what you're really talking about. And an appropriate way to answer that question would be, Your Honor, like if you really don't know, you know, you can say, Your Honor, it may be possible that the conspiracy charges weren't valid, but what's at issue before the court today is not the conspiracy charge, it's the charge for whatever it was, I can't remember, wiretapping. It's the wiretapping charge, and the reason that we win that is blank. Just say what you need to say, redirect them. It's not being not deferential. You don't want to get caught up in a discussion about something that's not on point and that you know nothing about. The third one that I wanted to talk about is how you run from a question that's really bad. Let's say you've just gotten hammered on whether or not the statute actually says something. You think you've answered it, and the judge just keeps asking you. He clearly does not like your explanation, does not like your argument. You need to get away from the argument. You need to have a backup. You need to have somewhere to go. But you don't want to go there by just completely abandoning the line of discussion with no sort of warning. Like the judge says, is that really what it says? And your immediate answer is, well, Your Honor, I have another point. And my second point is blank. Because the problem is, and I was talking about this earlier with someone, the problem is the judge doesn't necessarily disagree with your point. He may just be pushing you to see what you do. And you do want to move on because you don't want to be repeating yourself over and over again, but you don't want to abandon the position as though you recognize it has no merit and you're just going to get away from it as quickly as you can. You want to say, no, Your Honor, I believe that is what the statute says if you look at this and this. But even if you don't think that's what the statute says, or but even if I don't win on that point, I have a second point. So just make sure that when you're moving on, you're not abandoning your prior positions before you move on.
At this point, we'd like to open up ourselves to any questions that you guys may have, so we'll take those.
And also, if y'all have to leave for class or anything, Dave and I are around all day today and tomorrow, so you can ask Chris where we're going to be, and feel free to ask us then. But I saw a question up there.
Bless you.
I keep getting conflicting advice about hand gestures. What do you think about that?
I'll tell you what I think is, the kind of general rule is the podium is your limit. You know, hand gestures within the, draw a line from the podium up and down. If your hand gestures are within here, you're pretty much okay. You don't need to be doing this. But to the extent that people tell you not to use them at all, if you're the kind of person who talks with your hands like I am, it's very hard for me not to do that. And when I attempt to do that, I end up just looking worse. I end up looking stiff or gripping the podium. And so I always tell people, don't do anything that's completely unnatural for you to do, because it's not going to come across well. But to the extent that you're doing anything crazy like this, you know, try to keep it within the bounds of the podium. And try not to do anything that's too repetitive. There are some people who'll do this while they talk all the time, and that gets back to what we call a distraction. But if you're just a person who does this every now and then, some people will tell you to stop. If you can't stop, you can't stop. And in the end, it's really a very minor point.
Yeah, no pantomiming. None of that. Any other questions?
Maybe I'm really bad at this, but if you run out of stuff to say, you still have time left. I mean, I understand you probably don't want to get really repetitive, but say the judges really aren't asking questions or anything like that. And, I mean, what do you do in that situation? Because I felt like it looked bad to end early.
Well, I'll tell you, in my first Hardt Cup round, before I found out I made the board, I sat down at the five-minute mark. Nobody asked me anything. I said everything I had to say, and I sat down, and I thought, like, that was it. Like, I almost didn't even sign up for the last two rounds because I thought it was over. And in fact, it didn't work out that way. So what I think is, if you've really been persuasive, if you've hit the points you wanted to hit, if you've convinced the judges and you sit down, I mean, you just need to sit down. What you don't want to do is stand up there and rehash or invite more questions that are bad or kind of, you know, lose any ground that you've made before the judges. If you've seen the two-minute card, I think for sure you're fine. Now, you don't want to sit down when the judges still have questions. Like, okay, and so if no one else has any more, like, I'm just going to run and sit down. But if you've seen the two-minute card and you've really said all you need to say and think you've said it well, I personally would just sit down. It's a little harder call if it's only been 5 or 6 minutes. What do What do you think, Dave?
I totally agree.
Okay.
If you're asked a question that is going to really kill your argument, like a language question that you just have to answer in a certain way, and it's, you know, I heard you saying it's really good to be direct about it, what do you do next other than go to a completely different argument? Like, I'm concerned there's, like, such a gap between, you know, admitting that and then going to a different line of an argument. That's going to sound bad.
Look, here's the deal. If you get asked a question that's potentially harmful, like maybe there's a Ninth Circuit case that's dispositive, or maybe there's a fact in the record, take it on. I mean, what you have to say is, yes, the Ninth Circuit did hold X, but the facts in that case are distinguishable from the facts in this case, and furthermore, the Ninth Circuit case is not binding on this Supreme Court, and that's sort of the approach I would take. I would never just answer the question and then move on to another part of your argument, and I don't know if that's what you intended to say, but I would never just answer a bad question and then move on. It would be the case that you would answer a bad question and make this case different from the bad fact. The bad fact is not determinative. That bad case is not dispositive. And to sort of concede the bad point if you have to, but really attack it after that.
Yeah, and I'm not sure exactly what point you're talking about, but even if you're looking at the language of the statute and somebody says, but doesn't the language say this? Well, I mean, obviously the answer is yes, the language does say that, but the real answer is yes, the language says that, but here's why that language isn't the end of what we look at, because we go to this other section and it says this, or we go to this other section and it says this, or that language has been interpreted as this. Just, I mean, you do have, what was that? You do have to acknowledge it, but find a way to make that at least facially work for you so that it gives you something to say. And then, you know, if it really is like the worst point of your argument and you want to say, yes, that's true, but we should also look at this, and now I'm going to move on, then that's also fine.
You guys generally are saying to come in with some bullet points, ideas, and not have a speech written out. But what if you're in Chris's situation? They don't ask any questions. You sit up there for 6-7 minutes. And you don't have anything to say. You don't have any speech. You just have your general bullet points.
Well, but there's nothing wrong with that because you don't want to have a speech. You want to have a sort of areas that you want to cover. Just because it's not written out word for word in front of you doesn't mean that you have nothing to say. It just means that you're not scripted. You can get up there just like I am right now. What I'm saying right now, I don't have written down on a piece of paper in front of me, but yet I'm able to communicate the sort of ideas that I know I want to cover because it's in a bullet on an outline that I've already packed up. I mean, the main idea when you get up, even if you don't get asked any questions, is that you know that you have to cover points A, B, C, D, and E. And the reason I suggest that you only put them down in bullet form on a piece of paper is that most likely you're going to get a question by a judge that requires you to answer E, and then C, and then D, and then A, and then B, or maybe not even ever get to B because the judge doesn't think that's important, and then just go straight to C. And so that's why I say that. But if you don't get asked a single question, you know what you need to cover. And you know what the standard of review is, you know what your name is, you know who you represent, you know what the facts of the case are, and you know what the legal issues are that are involved in the case, and you can talk about those issues coherently and intelligently in front of a group, even though none of the stuff that I just listed is on any piece of paper in front of me. So you always have stuff to say, it's just that it's not scripted. And it may not come out the same way 2 times in a row, and you may not make every single point, but I guarantee you you're better off that way. Just making points as opposed to reading a script, I guarantee you're always better off that way.
And I think Dave's a little more extreme than I am. I always have 2 sheets of paper when I go up, and they probably look something like this, which is my outline for today. But what it is that instead of writing down in the Eighth Circuit case of Goodman versus Schulte, they held this, you just write, you know, Goodman, Eighth Circuit. And so you know when you look down, oh, I need to talk about the Goodman case from the Eighth Circuit. Or you write down, you know, ADA includes internet, and then your bullets are plain language of statute, section whatever, DOJ guidelines. Like, that's what it looks like. And so you know when you get up there, okay, my first point's going to be that the ADA covers the internet. The first reason is, oh, the plain language. But then you don't need to look down again. You look up and you talk about the plain language for 2 or 3 or 4 minutes. And you look down, DOJ guidelines. Okay, now I'm going to talk about DOJ guidelines. That's really what we mean. Not that you need to go up there and somehow be able to talk for 10 minutes with nothing with you.
It's not like you're winging it. I mean, because at this point, if you're at a stage where you can just write down on a piece of paper, Goodman, parentheses 8 to stand for the Eighth Circuit, and a quick 3-word refresher, it's not scripted, everything you're going to say about the case, but it's going to jog enough in your mind that you know what to talk about. And you can stretch those, that one line of text on a bullet into probably a couple minutes of talking. And so, I mean, that's why I say that. I mean, it may not, like I said, it may not come out the same way two times in a row. But so long as you're talking about that Eighth Circuit case, you're talking about the general holding, and you know the case because you've read it, you're better off not having it scripted, because it's going to force you to look up, maintain eye contact with the judges, and not read. Because one of the biggest criticisms judges have, and I think it's on most score sheets, is eye contact and did he read? And if the answer is yes, he read, and no, he had bad eye contact, you're going to lose a bunch of points. You're probably not going to win the round. So it's better to have good eye contact and not read than it is to read word for word and get it perfect.
And that's not to say that your first outline won't look different from your last outline that you actually take up there, because you do need to think everything through. And I tend to be a person who writes a lot of stuff down, and then I just pare it down for when I'm actually going to go up there.
Well, I'd like to thank Dave and Nicole again for being here and for doing this presentation.
Thanks.
It was our pleasure. Thank you for having us. We enjoy doing this.
And we didn't get booklets during the summit last week.